I'm Phil Lewis. I'd like to cover a little bit on the data architecture when you're deciding. Pods provides you advanced content types. It also allows you to extend any of the built-in WordPress types. It can get overwhelming. How do I pick? What am I going to use? Which one am I going to choose to do? So, it's unfortunately not a basic question. This is going to be a more theoretical talk. A lot of things depend on understanding a bit about relational database structure. You can't make decisions on how you're going to do your architecture without understanding a little bit about relational databases. Performance can be a consideration, depending on how many records you have. WordPress interoperability. If you use the built-in WordPress types, you get a chance to... thanks. You get a chance to... you knocked me off my...
Sorry about that.
Work with other plugins that know how to work with the WordPress content types. And a lot of it depends on what you need to do with the data itself. So, skip to me. There we go. A lot of people start off, they come from a spreadsheet background. They'll create a table like this. It's a big, flat, wide table with everything in one table. You run into some issues if you design like this. For example, Bill Smith decides to move teams. It's not necessarily very easy to change that. The team colors decide to change. Now you have to go and find where all these are. The average score that Bill has had is not something that should be stored in the database directly. That's probably something that should be calculated based on separate score tables and so forth. So there are a black art involved in something called database normalization. Well beyond the scope of this, there's a lot of information on Google. Some of it applies to, or a lot of it applies to what you're going to do with data types in WordPress. A lot of it is, or some of it won't necessarily apply to WordPress itself. You want to break things down into entities and relationships. If you have players, you want to put them in their own content type, and teams, and join those up. That way, when you want to change a player's name, someone gets married, you change it in one spot, and all the relationships automatically pick up those changes. So, performance isn't the only consideration when you set up your data types. We think that we want to go with the fastest thing, so we've done all of our research, we've looked out there, and price-wise, Corvette is the fastest thing we can get. So we go out and get the Corvette, and in week two, we discover that we need to move a couple of tons of gravel. So we optimized for the wrong thing. We optimized for speed, and we needed to optimize for something else. And in today's world, with the performance continuing to improve every year, the memory improving, a lot of times the performance is good enough that you can have a compromise. Not the most efficient way to do things, but it opens up opportunities to do things more flexibly. So, WordPress native types. This is the setting page. I like to choose, whenever possible, WordPress native types first. You have the interoperability, other plugins that are well-written, themes that are well-written will know about your data that you have in there. With the settings page, we'll start there because that's a real easy decision. It's a single, basically one value, one row pod. You get no items in it. It's perfect for a front page template. You want to store some settings that are only used in one spot, only one row. And it's way easier than using the WordPress settings API directly. This is a pretty no-brainer. If you're in that situation, settings page is the way to go. With native custom post types and taxonomies, again, you get interoperability if you go this route with well-written plugins and themes. You get all the advantages of the automatic URL rewriting, the archive pages, the template hierarchy. It just knows about your custom post types. It knows where the archive page should be. It should know where each single page can be. And you don't have to do anything special for it. And you and any programs you have working on the site can leverage your existing WordPress knowledge. You don't have to learn a new API, new things for it. So. Now, the storage that is used when you're using both custom post types and users and you're adding new data to those is known as metadata in WordPress. People that have worked with databases a lot are maybe familiar with EAV, known as entities, attributes, and values. You basically have whatever the attribute is, color, the value is there, and you can add a whole bunch of those. WordPress out there is used, I saw the recent statistics that of sites that have a known CMS, 60% of them are using WordPress now. They somehow managed to do that with only 11 tables in a core non-multi-site installation. It's a lot easier for people to understand and adopt that if they don't have 50 tables to try and figure out all the relationships. And let's see, oh, this one's the belongs in the post and the user. Taxonomies don't have a meta table yet in open source. We always say yet because Scott's really close with the meta team.
The meta team within WordPress is still pushing for meta tables for taxonomies. It's gone back and forth between close and not close, but you know, only time can tell. But I'm pretty sure it's headed in the direction where it may get a meta table. Because of just how useful they could be for like very simple content types like taxonomies versus like really more complex types like post types. So we'll have to see how that goes.
And how metadata works is there's basically an extra row for every value that you want to tack on to something. So you would have, this would be your meta key and your meta value if you're in one of your meta tables in WordPress. And for each thing that you want to add to a specific sprocket, this would be the exact same sprocket. You add one more row with basically what it is and what it holds. And that way, it's a very flexible solution. You can add as much as you need. You can have 100 pieces of meta attached to one item. You can have no pieces of meta, what they call a sparse matrix, if you have something set up like that to where you only have a few values. There may be hundreds of meta values available to you that you may need to store, but you only need a few per record. So that can be fairly actually efficient for that. Easy to provide interoperability. Everything fits in the same size box. WordPress knows how to go look and see what kind of meta is available for any particular item. And you avoid extra tables. And if you're doing large setups, WordPress.com, for example, millions of sites, if they had 60 tables, that's a whole lot more tables and a whole lot more database that they would be keeping rather than 11 in a basic installation. But metadata is not great for everything. Not one size fits all. It scales very, very poorly if you get a lot of metadata. The number of meta fields that you have attached to an item times the number of items, because there's one row for each one of those, is the number of meta rows you end up with. The man with 6 million records over there knows what I'm talking about. If you have 1,000 items and 50 pieces of meta, you now have 50,000 rows in your meta table. So it does not scale well at all. Text field indexes, which is how meta value, if you need to do any sorting, any kind of filtering with a lot of meta, they're slower than numeric indexes. If you need to do joins and sorting and filtering on things that are using WordPress IDs, a whole lot faster than if you need to search for, you know, what color. I want to only find the black things if it's stored in meta. It's a whole lot slower. And the SQL complexity can go through the roof. You can end up with a whole lot of joins for each time that you go to the meta table for a different piece for the same item. There's some tricks that you can work around that with. It will a little beyond the scope of this here. So there's not a concrete number that I can give as where do I decide that I have too many things and I need to go with an advanced content type. Advanced content types for pods have their own table. So you get around that meta storage in that each value that you need has its own field in the same row. But it really depends a lot on what you're going to do. If you don't need to search on a lot of that meta, if you're only going to pull a half a dozen records at a time and then pull the meta for those half a dozen records, it's not too bad. If you need to go through and find, I need to narrow down out of 6 million meta rows, then it can start to get slow. So it's a black art. It's a little bit difficult. And it kind of depends a lot on what you need to do with the data. But we have an alternative if you do need to get outside of the meta approach that will give you a lot more efficiency. So bit of a whirlwind that blew through that faster than planned, but any questions on it?
We also have a comparison on our doc site. Two of them really, really very handy. This comparison section here. And you can compare your content types, like what content type do you actually need. You can actually find out what you may need based off of this grid here. It shows you what features are in what. Extremely helpful, as well as comparing the storage types, meta versus table. It gives you some just basic things here, and also gives you some more in-depth database comparison, like what you may see if you have data and different things. WordPress has sort of changed a little bit, but it's just about the same numbers here. But it's totally makes sense. Like that guy with the 6 million rows, if he has 10 fields or 20 fields or 50 fields, he's looking at having to have a really, really expensive bill for his hosting for database. And especially if he wants to query a lot of that, not only is he going to have an expensive bill, he's going to scale up even further to make it fast.
You're going to time it with a calendar, not a stopwatch.
Yeah, at that point, like he's spending more time on scaling up than his code. And at that point, like if you can optimize your code, you don't actually have to scale up at all. So it's a give and take, but depending on what you want, meta versus table. Yes.
And then there's one other consideration, which is on your admin UI. Whether you want things nested under an admin panel or have it on its own, so taxonomies right now is the only way you can nest. You can't nest.
You can. Well, in PodsCamp, we have an option for that in the admin UI, and you can also set taxonomies as their own root level menus as well.
So work with post types. I know it works with ACT.
Yeah. You can't nest post types under.
Yep.
Every...
You can. Well, in ours you can.
There's a hierarchical option that we've added for, I know for ACT.
You can set the parent ID for it, and it'll move it.
Oh, okay. We can be able to show you an example.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
I've used it because it's very, very handy. Yeah.
We're good then.